أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين شفيع ذنوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد. وآله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين وأصحابه المنتجبين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد، السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. So we stated that in essence the vertical axis is what is important, and the horizontal axis is that which is in a state of flux. Together with that, the human condition is one of growth and evolution and self-realization. The vertical axis has to be such that it promotes and gives a sense of growth, self-realization at every level of human existence, whether it is the intellectual level, in which we want to break forth from our restrictions, or at a moral level where we want to become godly individuals and do good to others, or whether it is at a social level where we want social harmony, cohesion, want to learn from each other and grow together. All of these things are to be accommodated by that beautiful theology, the theology which is God-centric, that removes our insecurities, that instills within us confidence in our humanity, that tells us that your human condition is deliberately placed in the way that it is. It's been constructed in the way that it is, that you will always want to break forth. You will always want to self-realize your godliness. This is the salient truth. The horizontal axes are there to accommodate the growth of the human being along the vertical. So the vertical gives us a lofty sense of purpose. It breaks our limited outlooks. It gives us a broader vision, and we are only as great as our vision is. I have said this on many occasions. Maybe it is befitting to restate this at this point, that a human person and a human community is only as great as the vision that they have, is only as great as their worldview and their outlook. Everything is contingent in the way in which we understand life and the meaning of life. If we were to understand the earth as being flat, of course we will not venture out into the ocean beyond a certain limit. We will not build big enough crafts to cross the mighty oceans. Our motion, technology, evolution will all be curtailed through the limited worldview and our vision and our understanding of life and purpose. The broader the vision we have, the greater the worldview that we have, the greater humans we become. When the Prophet of Islam came to his community, he said to them, "Leave aside the whole notion of predestiny. Take the reins of your destiny into your own hands and carve out your destiny. The world is yours. Take it. Do good to this world and contribute in a meaningful manner." Within no time, those nomadic people contribute to a civilization that the world still salutes today. From people who were confined to the shimmering sands of Arabia, who could not read or could not write, to what the Prophet contributed, to people who imported the Greek sciences, their understanding, developed it and gave it to the rest of the world, which was still in dark ages. This is how phenomenal these people were. From people who buried their daughters, to now the Orientalist right that the first person to institutionalize the rights of women was Muhammad, the messenger of the Arabs. A person who comes to a community that is bloodthirsty, leaves them as a league of nations that do not tolerate each other but appreciate each other and appreciate the others that are not Muslims and embrace them in a greater godly vision. This was all made possible by this great man opening up their minds in the sense of the essence in which they really ought to have been, and in terms of the vertical axis and that beautiful theology. And he said to them that I will now formulate for you a system whereby you can exist and arrive at those befitting morals that make you godly. So just to recap, the first thing he gave was that lofty sense of existence, that purposeful existence. He impressed upon their minds that this life is an opportunity that you have sought from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a favor of God upon you that you are alive. He would often say to them that read this verse, inna fi khalqis samawati wal ard, indeed in the creation of the heavens and the earth, and in the changing of the days and the night, and in the flowing of the ships on the oceans, there are signs for those who think. He would say to them, how shameful it is that you read this verse, your beards turn white, and you do not reflect upon this verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you this opportunity. It's a very heavy responsibility. You will be answerable for this on the day of Qiyamah. If you waste it, you will be answerable. You are here with a purpose, and your purpose is a noble one. God has blown His spirit inside you. You are the Khalifa of Allah on the face of this earth. This level of bestial existence does not befit you. You are well beyond all of these things. You are not criminals who I need to threaten with the whip or with the fire of hell. You are noble people. Your nobility will carry you forward. Your nobility and godliness is the impetus for you to grow morally, technologically, intellectually. And then he gave them this worldview in which he said, forget the earth. The earth is for you. Do you not see what God says in the Quran? He has made the heavens and the earth subservient to you. Everything is yours. Leave aside this earth, he said. Look at those galaxies. Why wouldn't the Arabs want to ask this question? Why didn't they say this, Ya Rasulullah, we are earthbound. Why do you talk of those lofty galaxies? Obviously, the aim was that this human being traverses the lofty galaxies. That's the only reason the Quran said this, that as the heavens birth forth, they are like a rose dipped in oil. Today, with Hubble telescope's pictures, we see beautiful galaxies bursting forth, or the stellar constellations that we see, or stellar nurseries as they form their galaxies. One of the pictures looks like a rose dipped in oil. The reason why these verses were revealed were to broaden their perspectives, were to broaden their minds that look, you do not belong to the earth. Yours is the universe. Take it in the palm of your hand. You're the Khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he broadens their minds. He gives them a vision. He gives them a worldview that is unlimited, that increases them in their growth. And that is the only befitting worldview. I will discuss this towards the end. But tell me, what leads us from today into tomorrow? A sense of optimism that tomorrow will be better than today, wouldn't it? Why do we raise our children? So that they may become something, they may attain something. Optimism fills us. Hope and optimism is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maybe at this point we can narrate that story of Ali ibn Abi Talib salamullah alayhi. What a beautiful story, in which a man comes to him and he says, oh Ali, explain to me the existence of God on my terms. He said, what are your terms? He says, my terms are that I find it very difficult to believe in the existence of God in dire circumstances. So Imam said, then think of impossible circumstances. He said that when I am at sea and there are mighty waves ahead of me and the night is black, who comes and helps me at that point? Where is God? Imam said, let us compound the horrors of the situation. Imagine now that your ship is wrecked and you are clinging on to a plank of wood from the wreckage of the ship, and there's a mighty wave about to overtake you and engulf you. He said, now pause. Go deep inside yourself. Ask yourself before that mighty wave strikes you. Think inside yourself, is there anything at this point that can save you? Can intervention occur at this point? Do you still have a shred of hope in your soul that you might come through this? He paused. In silence, he went into his soul. He said, Ali, yes. Even at that point, I will not lose hope. Imam said, that is God within you. God is hope. Hope for a better tomorrow. He is nothing but optimism. And optimism spurs on growth. And that is the Prophet. The Prophet gave them optimism, gave them confidence in their own souls, in their own abilities, in their own humanness, in their own frailty, in their own weakness, in their own sinfulness. He gave them hope. He said, you are meant to be like this, but through this, evolve and Allah is with you. And the verses upon verses that came, Huwa ma'akum aynama kuntum, He is with you wherever you are. Yadullah fawqa aydihim, the hand of God is on their hands. Go forth, I am with you. Explore your abilities, your possibilities. This was the essence, the vertical. The Prophet said, now, in order to make all of that possible in this context, I will give you a minimalistic set of principles of good human existence. You do the rest yourselves. You evolve now through these principles. So now, the stumbling block for the Muslims is the same book that gave them this evolutionary growth from a pagan-like state to that noble state of humanity, the same book of God which is growth promoting is the book that becomes a point of stagnation, not only stagnation, of regression. And this is something that the modern Muslim finds inconsistent with his human condition of growth, with their intuition. They say, yes, we know intuitively that Islam is all that you say, but when we read Islam, we do not find it resonating the sentiments that you are talking about. And yet we know it is Islam. By priority, Allah has to be this way. When we ask anyone, do you think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will favor one over another? They will say no. Do you think Allah does not want you to be good to the others? They will say no. Do you think Allah is not condoning the whole discussion of human rights? They will say yes. But the Quran talks about slavery. The Quran talks about distinctions in human classes. How is that possible? So the very Quran, which is liberating, which is a source of life, growth, promotion of humanity, has become a stumbling block in the minds of the Muslims. This is nothing to do with the Quran. It's the failure of the Muslim mind. And this is what we need to explain. That the Muslim mind has failed. They have conflated between the vertical and the horizontal axis. They don't understand properly the existential principles in which the Quran came and the existential principles through which the human being abides. That is the fundamental. The Quran is in line with that. In order to understand the Quran, we need to interpret it against the human existential principles. So let us state this, that the vertical is always the same, that beautiful God-centricity that liberates us. But how do we grow through Islam? That is the same message the true Islam has been giving from the time of Adam or from the time of Ibrahim till the time of Khatam Salamullah Alayhim Ajmain. But how does this Islam in which Quran has been revealed, how does Judaism in which Torah has been revealed, how does Christianity in which Injil has been revealed, how do these religions now reconcile that beautiful essence with their restrictive codes of law that they have in their religion, with their prescriptive regulations that are so restrictive? How to reconcile between the two? It does not mean that the revelations are wrong. It means that the fault lies in the appreciation of this revelation. This is the problem. Today, the Muslims will justify every detestful act through the Quran or through the Hadith. I'll just cite a Hadith or two to emphasize this thing as we go into this subject. We have a Hadith within the Sunni text that do jihad with every leader, even if it is a false jihad. You will have the thawab of doing jihad, and the leader will have the sin of killing innocent people. Which mind can accept something like this? Which mind can accept something like this? And similar things you have in Shia literature. This and these sort of texts justify every immoral act. What is happening is that we have not understood accurately what the scriptures are saying. Now I'll take you a step back to yesterday to go into this discussion more fully. What did we say yesterday? That when Ibrahim's Suhuf were replaced by Moses' Torah, did the essence change? Did God-centricity change? Did human morality change? What changed? You said none of these things changed. The vertical was intact, the essence was intact. What changed was the horizontal one, how to attain that befitting morality. That's what you told me, didn't you? From Moses to Isa, Injil came. Did Injil change the vertical axis? Did it say don't be God-centric? Did it say don't be moral human beings? No, it said the same thing. So what changed? What do you mean a new Sharia came? In terms of Sharia, the theology is still the same. The morality is still the same. So what has changed? The way in which social and individual morality is formulated changed. That's the only thing that changed. How you attain this moral status. When the Prophet of Islam came with Islam, did he change God-centricity of Injil or human morality? He didn't change any of those things. Otherwise, the Prophet would not say, we believe in everything that's revealed unto us and believe in everything revealed unto you. He wouldn't say that, would he? It means that the vertical axis is the same. The only thing that changed was the formulation of this morality, how we attain this beautiful sense of righteous existence. That's the only thing that changed. That is the horizontal axis. The horizontal axis, the only reason they changed from Ibrahim to Musa, Musa to Isa, Isa to Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was because the human community was changing. And as the human community changed, it required different formulations. That example, once again, a child is only taught what is right from kindergarten till graduation, but the textbooks change. He is being taught, or she is being taught the same thing, but the textbooks are changing. They are formulating things in different ways. Yes? And the same textbook for the same child in two different locations of the world will not work. You have to be mindful of their own dynamics, their social, political, economical dynamics, before you can teach them the same thing in a different way. So the same thing is taught, but in different ways, in different locations, at the same time, isn't it? And from year to year, the truth, 1 plus 1, remains the same, but it's formulated differently from year to year to year, in order to bring out the best in the child, but the principle are the same. So now, when the Prophet came to his community, the first thing he does, he gives them that sense of lofty purpose. And then says to them, your success is contingent upon your own selves. If you realize your humanity to the fullest, you've done it. If you realize the humanity of your collective body, you've done it. How do we do that? That is when he starts to formulate. And that is the horizontal axis. This is what we want to talk about now. When we say Quran is eternal, it is eternal in its essence. It doesn't have to be eternal in its formulation. If you were to say Quran is eternal in its formulation, then I will ask you, what about abrogation inside the Quran? We all believe abrogation has occurred inside the Quran, don't we? Do you know abrogation? Shall I explain that? Yes. Abrogation is naskh of the Quran. The Muslims were facing Jerusalem for their prayers, and they were told to face Kaaba. The law was abrogated. The Muslims used to fast at night in the month of Ramadan. They used to only be allowed one meal at night. That's it. They weren't allowed to go near their wives for throughout the month. That was abrogated 2 verses later. eat as much as you want till daybreak, sorry, till Fajr. Yes? And you can be with your spouses on the nights of Ramadan. These are known as abrogations. So when the first part of the Quran came, and then it was abrogated, how is that law eternal? The fact that Quran was abrogating itself, what does that mean? That the human community was growing. A formulation that worked for them in the initial stages of introduction of Islam in Medina did not work for them at a later date. So the Quran abrogated it. It reformulated the whole hukam, the whole law. Can you see that? In line with the vertical axis of attaining godliness, social goodness, individual evolution. Are we getting this? So now, the Quran abrogates itself. Where is the eternity of it? The Muslims still want to go and cut hands. They still want to go and beat their women. They still want to say two women to one man. They still want to say the share of inheritance of a woman is half that of a man. Regardless of the mode of society in which we exist, I can understand. In Iran, where the woman is a carer and man is a provider, that the man gets two shares and woman gets one share. But in the West, where the woman is a carer and a provider, why should she get half the share that the man gets? Here we see the feminists are up in arms. And they're saying, what sort of Islam is this? We know it is true, but we don't know how to argue against it. We know Islam is the rightful religion because when we read the Quran, we find such a beautiful God. When we look at the prophetic era, we find him a noble human being, the glory of humanity, fairness and righteousness. But when we read this law of the Quran, it doesn't make sense to us and the hadith. It is very, very unfair. When we look at inalienable human rights, and we look at our text that does not give the same equal rights to the Jews and the Christians, leave aside the non-Abrahamic faiths, we are faced with a shocking situation. Intuitively, we know Allah cannot ordain anything but equality, but our law system doesn't give them equality. What's going on? We are baffled. Can you see that? We want to grow. We want to grow. We want to evolve. We want to become a moral community. The same book that gave us evolution, liberated us, give us growth, is now becoming a means of restriction. This is nothing to do with the Quran, as we will explain. The eternity of the Quran is in its essence. Now, as we go into these lectures, and I want to be very careful to phrase this carefully. Mawlana Sahib just read Surah Waqia for us. Innahu la Quranun Kareem fi kitabin maknoon. Something like that. La yamassuhu illa al-mutahharoon. This is the Quranul Kareem. In the locked book, in the hidden book. If you read the Quran says we gave Moses the Kitab, Jesus the Kitab, Muhammad the Kitab. There is emphasis on Kitab, 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 Kitab. The Kitab is called Torah, the Kitab is called Injil, the Kitab is called Quran. Kitab is a reality of all realities that Allah has. What is being revealed to me and you is in accordance with our aptitude. It is not the Quran of Allah that we have. It is the Quran of Allah in a form that is accessible to me and you. Marhum Imam Khomeini used to say that this Quran has gone through 70 filters before it has reached you. And that is why you find the camel inside there and a horse inside there. Otherwise, the essence of Quran is هو الأول والآخر وظاهر والباطن. The essence of the Quran is that he is the first, he is the last, he is the apparent, he is the hidden. The rest of it is in order to make it accessible to you that it has come in this language. And that's why Allah says, none can touch it save the most purified. Those beautiful prophetic and imam's intellect that's so purified that by looking at the verse of the Quran, they can touch the eternal word of God. And they can arrive at the eternal essence of the Quran. Otherwise, the rest of it is in our context. It's eternal. It is no doubt a miracle. No doubt this Quran that we have is a miracle. Nobody can argue. The level of consistency, the phrases, the words, the scientific truths, the cosmological truths, it's mind-blowing. It's baffling. The fluctuations within the Quran, I think we should actually just contribute a month talking about the Quran and the wonders of the Quran. But the Muslim mind has failed in not realizing that this Quran is in a context. Now, let's explain this. The Prophet had to formulate that beautiful vertical axis in a law system that allows me and you to gain greater growth and become moral individuals who are godly and God-centric. How do we get there? We said, Ya Rasulullah. So Rasulullah, through the Quran, had to formulate those sentiments. Yes? It is like a student saying, fine, I want to be that professor. How do I do it? What do? We formulate, okay, study this, after finishing this, then study this, then this, that's extracurricular classes here, there. We have to formulate, don't we? And we will change the formulations. So the Prophet had to formulate. Now, before you can formulate, you have to bear in mind the context in which you are formulating. Yes? If I were to go to the Amazonian climate and talk about the thirst of Imam Hussein, they will not understand it. It doesn't mean anything to them because they never thirst. If an alien were to come down who doesn't understand emotions, if I were to talk about the Shahada of Hazrat Ali Asghar, they won't understand it. For them, life and death is something totally different to the way we understand it. If an alien comes here who doesn't understand hunger, if I were to talk about global poverty, they won't understand what we're talking about. Formulation has to be in accordance with the context in which it is formulated. Is that agreed? Does that make sense? Now, the language that the Prophet speaks is a language that is to be comprehended by the people of his time. So he cannot move out of the parameters of the language. Is that agreed? If the Prophet brought a different language, it would have been useless for them. The example that the Prophet gives have to be examples that are in accordance with the knowledge base of his community. He can't give examples that they can't understand. The items he talks about are items that are familiar to the community in which he comes. So the Prophet can't talk about kangaroos because they don't know what kangaroo is. Do you find a kangaroo in the Quran? But you said everything is inside the Quran, didn't you? Isn't it your claim that there is everything inside the Quran? Where is the kangaroo? The Prophet can't talk about bananas. Unless somebody says there is a mention of banana, I'm not sure. To the best of my understanding, all these years I haven't read about a banana. He's not going to talk about a banana, is he? Because it is not within the knowledge base. So the Prophet is restricted into how he gives these lofty truths. The lofty truths are to be given in two ways. One, in a language that is understood in the restrictions of the community. Yes? Two, in a language that is ambiguous enough to allow them to grow through those examples. Yes? True? Now, the Prophet is going to give a law of bearing witness and testimonials in the Quran. Listen to this carefully. So the Prophet sees that the man are extremely acquainted with retaining information, but women are kept childlike. They are uneducated, they are always beaten, they are inherited by one from one man to another. Read Surah An-Nisa and see the barbaric situation that existed in Arabia, the situation of women and the situation of the orphans. They are being killed. If you guys can get a time, watch Genghis Khan, Making of Genghis Khan. Watch that movie. Their social morality was totally different. A woman can say to her husband, he is taking me, win him, win the battle against him, take me back to you. And then when the man would win the antagonist, the enemy, he would then have to decide, shall I take back my wife who has more children with him? Should I take them as my children? And by and large, they were doing that. That became their social morality. It was a barbaric state of affairs in which women were childlike. They were being beaten. They weren't reasoned with. They kept women in that state. Not all the women. Not all the women. Yes? But majority of the women, let us say, or a lot of the women. So now the Prophet says, I have to give them a role of how to bear testimonies. Men are accustomed to retaining knowledge. So two men should be enough. Now, if two men you can't find, you find one man and one woman. But one woman will not be able to retain it because they are not accustomed to retaining knowledge. So find two women so that if one starts forgetting, the other one can remind her. This is what the Quran says. It points at the essence of that law as well. That the essence of the law is accurate delivery of testimonials. The only reason it was one man and two women was because of the contextual restraint. The context was restrictive, and that's the reason, nothing else. So if women evolve to a level where they can retain knowledge accurately, there is no need for two women as opposed to one man. It all changes. Is that going through? Can I read this? Can I have a salawat, please? I know you will agree to these examples because the women are sitting here right now. So I can get away with it relatively easy. Now tell me, the diya, the blood money, for man is double, for woman it's half. It's only because the service lost to society back in the day was greater when the man was killed, because he's a provider. I mean, nobody likes to calculate life in monetary terms, but that's the hard and fast facts of life. And the loss of a woman is a lesser damage to a society back in the day. In today's day, when a woman is providing as a norm, then her death is equal to the death of a man. Then their blood money is equal as well, because the detriment to the society is equal in those regions where they are equal. Inheritance. If a woman is a provider in the West, she's a single parent, she's a provider, she's a carer. Man is only a provider. I would argue that the woman's share of inheritance be doubled in certain instances. These are the fluctuating horizontal axes in order to cater for the beautiful growth of the community. Islam is so flexible, so minimalistic, that it can fit in any given environment. What I'm trying to say here is that there were restrictions within the context. I call them contextual restrictions and limitations. Now, let's talk about one another component before we come to some hardcore examples. There is a natural relativity upon this earth. With the law of individuality, everything is an individual, yes? We have communities growing at different rates. I have just written an article from the Quran and the hadiths of Imam Sadiq Salamullah Alayhi that the age of bulugh for girls is not 9 or not 8. That was in that embryonic system of the Prophet. As it matured, as their lifestyles changed, as they began to eat different foods, they became a very sophisticated community. You can't have one cutoff point for all types of responsibilities. It's crazy to say that a girl of 9 is responsible for all her actions, lock, stock and barrel, and she can own all her property and do with it whatever she wants. She just does not have the capacity in this day and age. The level of maturity is different, and from different capacity, there are different capacities and different aptitudes for different responsibilities. In the West, we have a different age for being able to vote, a different age for being able to consume alcohol and smoking cigarettes, and a different age of consent and a different age of marriage, because it is always fluctuating. In Brazil, it's very different. In UK, it's very different. In Ireland, it's very different. There is this natural relativity. Each country tries to understand what is the best system here of responsibility in accordance with aptitudes and capacities. There are different capacities for different responsibilities. You cannot stone to, in fact, there is no stoning to death in the Quran in the first instance. You cannot kill a child who doesn't have a sense of what they are doing. There are different levels of responsibility. In the prophetic community, it was a very basic community. It needed a cutoff point, but the Quran does not talk about an age. Think about it. All the Muslims say zakat, zakat, zakat. I'm saying in the Quran, where do you find zakat being apportioned in terms of extensions? Where do you find it in the Quran? They give zakat on dates, on horses, on camels. You don't, do you? The Quran only talks about zakat, because every region is supposed to cater for their welfare requirements and needs. Every region's requirements are different from every other. It was supposed to be an open hand for the human mind to evolve, to formulate a system of zakat, to change, chop, add, minus, subtract, and go on. Are you telling me that the Prophet came without a taxation system? Of course not. The Prophet brought in a taxation system, which was zakat, which was also a spiritual act, which we might explain at a later date, that he shrouded all mundane acts with spirituality. But he left zakat open. He said, because it will change. In one region it will change. And then it will change from region to region. Every region will have different sense of zakat in accordance with their own welfare needs. This is something that was in a flux. Now, cut off their hands. Cut off their hands. This cutting off the hands has to have an essence inside it. Is it individual reform? Protection of society? Is it retribution? What is it? In accordance with any of these theories, you will find that you can replace it. Now, I said, we gave an example yesterday that in Nabi Nuh's time, everybody was destroyed. Only a few survived. In Hud and Saleh. But when you come to Shu'aib, many people are being saved. When you come to Musa, so many are being saved. When you come to Isa, no punishment is coming. When you come to Khatamun Nabiyyin, there is no punishment. As we are growing in terms with human dignity, in terms with human dignity, we are doing away these draconian punishments. We don't flog people anymore. We don't stone them to death anymore. It's not even in the Quran. We don't cut limbs anymore. But because of the relativity, if you go to the Amazonian jungles and people are stealing there and you don't have any other means of rehabilitating them or imprisoning them, then cutting off the hands there is fine. You can cut hands off there, but not in a sophisticated community, because it's evolved in a relativistic scheme. If there are women in some remote villages of Africa who can't retain knowledge as well as men, then it's fine to say one man and two women. But what about the regions where this evolution has taken place? The only thing that remains intact is the vertical. The horizontal is in a state of constant flux. Now, a man's right hand was cut. Left foot was cut due to stealing. In the time of the second Khalifa, Umar, he stole again. So the second Khalifa adjudicated and passed a judgment, cut his left hand off. Imam Ali came, he said, no, don't do that. Don't do that. Put him into prison. You can't leave him without a hand to see to his needs. The Quran says, cut their hands off. Imam Ali said, you can't do this because you can't leave him without any means to cater for his need. Then another hadith from Imam Ali. He says, I feel embarrassed to leave a man without any means to cater for his needs, for eating and for tahara. Put him into prison. And if he steals again, then kill him or do whatever else you want to do. But don't take his hand off. This is what the Imam said. Now, I can give examples upon examples where the Imams have changed and fluctuated the rule. For example, Imam Baqir, Salamullah Alayh, he introduced khums on gold and silver in 1 year. And the people were crying. He said, why? He said, look, I forgive you one share of the khums totally, the share of the God and Prophet and the Imam. I forgive that share, as did Imam Ali. But I'm increasing a share here because I have to cater for the needs of the community for 1 year. What else am I supposed to do? There is a need here. I need extra khums to cater for this need. It's a very pragmatic thing. So this is what I was trying to say. The Quran has to be seen as a pragmatic command of or set of instructions in terms of the ahkam. When we say pragmatic, what it means is in accordance with the context in which it is coming. The sacredness of the Quran is on the vertical. That is the essence. The eternity of the Quran is along the vertical. The fluctuating part of the Quran is along the horizontal. And that fluctuating part as well is eternal, but eternal in its ethos, not in its formulation. This is what we are trying to say, that if the modern Muslim finds it is stifled by the Quran, it is not the Quran that stifles it. It is the inability of the Muslim mind to read the Quran accurately that has stifled it. If the Prophet of Islam came today, in the modern world, where we are talking about human rights, he would have added to it so magnificently and beautifully. I mean, look at his teachings. Whenever the Jews had control of Jerusalem, you see what they are doing. Yes? I love the Jewish people. I'm just giving an example. Whenever the Christians had control of Jerusalem, they butchered the Muslims. Yes? Whenever the Muslims ruled upon Jerusalem, guess what? They allowed the Jewish and the Christian community to flourish and to grow. Why did they allow this? Because of the broadness of what Muhammad Rasulullah had taught them and the minimalistic Islam that he gave them. That is something that we have forgotten today. So if the Prophet were to have come today, he would have championed the cause of human rights. He would not have spoken about slavery. He had to speak about slavery because of the pragmatic needs of the community, because of the contextual limitations, and the Quran had to be pragmatic. Despite that, he institutionalizes a system where slaves are being freed for the sake of Allah, and it's being seen as the most commendable act. When we read the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what we say is, he did not come and devastate the discussion on human rights. He initiated the discussion on human rights, and that can only be the case because human rights are evolving with the evolution of humanity. They're not stagnant. He could have only initiated it. So when people say, what are the rights of women? My response is, the right of a person is accordance with their capacity. You can't arbitrarily give rights. Rights are in accordance with capabilities. As soon as the capacity is there and capability is there, they procure the right. It's nothing about digging your hand into the bag of rights and giving them a right and making them happy. It is always meant to be evolving. If the Prophet of Allah was here today, he would be a very different person. He would formulate that vertical axis in a manner befitting. I'll leave us with this. My time has finished. I'll leave us with this hadith, and inshallah we'll continue with the subject. That when the 12th Imam comes, according to the Shias, when he reappears, according to the Sunnis, when he takes birth, whatever. When the 12th Imam comes, he will bring a sense of Islam that the Muslims will say, he has changed Islam altogether. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. There were two questions that came in yesterday that I said we will respond to today. The Taraweeh prayers. We have a set of hadith from the Shias in Wasailu Shia, in which it is said that they said to Imam Ali, we want to pray Taraweeh and lead Taraweeh. He said, no, I will not do this. This is bid'ah. They started protesting. The Imam said, let them choose their Imam and pray. So it was my mistake. Imam did not choose an Imam for them. The hadith in the Sunni sources say, and this lady reports that he actually appointed two imams, Imam Ali, one for men and one for women. And I was the imam for the women. And her name is it important I mention her name, or should I just give it to the reference to whoever wants it? Yeah? Anyway, so these are, actually I'll give the name, it gives more credibility. And it was the second Khalifa, Umar, who said the prayer of his, the narration is that he saw people praying individually and groups. And he said, isn't it better if they all pray together? And he appointed Ubay bin Ka'b to lead them, the Sahabi of the Prophet, to lead them. They prayed, and then the second Khalifa said, this prayer is not as good as the prayer that they miss while sleeping, the Salatul Tahajjud. That prayer is far better, and that is why many of the Sunni scholars now are saying that it is better to be with your family, to take it easy, and not to pray the Taraweeh if it has become burdensome on you. Yes? I don't mean to offend anybody by this sort of hadith. Now, the hadith of the 72 sects. Roy Muttahada has written a book in which he says, if you're talking about the usul, there is no way near 72 sects. If you're talking about the sects of Islam, there are about 400-500 sects that historically have come. So that's what we were saying yesterday, that historically there have been 400-500 sects in Islam, even more. Yes? So these are the two responses for yesterday. I got an email asking for the reference of the people on Imam Ali's side praying with their arms folded, and on Muawiyah's side with their hands open. I've asked somebody to send that reference off to me through the historical sources. Inshallah, as soon as it's here, I'll share it. It is said, 1 hour of contemplation is better than 70 years of ibadat. What kind of contemplation is meant here? Any contemplation. It's a difference between a wakeful person and a sleeping person. The prophetic logic was that when you pray your salah, you're doing it robotically at times. If you think that how wonderfully Allah has created an ant, look at this small creature, so minute, but how wonderfully adapted it is to its environment. The beautiful way in which it functions, it fulfills its purpose, it has a respiratory system, it has a heart, it has everything so meticulous. What will that do? It will fill the mind with awe of God. And then when we say Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah, the heart will mean Alhamdulillah, Rabbal Alameen, then the heart will melt away in that prayer. And therefore, that one prayer after contemplation is better than 70 years of namaz without that contemplation. What is the importance of tabarra in religion? Should we apply it on our lives, yes or no? Okay, now, you have to be attentive to this, yes? Usuluddin, and many of you who've seen my 1 minute clips that are going around will already have seen this. Usuluddin in Islam are three, only three. Historically, check the Shia Sunni books. Tawheed, Risalat, and Qiyamat. These are the three things through which a Muslim becomes a Muslim. Then there was a confusion amongst the theologians. Does God punish whoever he wants to and gives paradise to whoever he wants to, or does he punish in accordance with our sins and give paradise in accordance with our good deeds? Is there good in namaz, or Allah just says it? This thing brought about the whole discussion on the nature of adalat of Allah, justice of Allah. So in order to clarify, the theologian says tawheed, adal, but adal is already a part of tawheed anyway, but they explained it more, tawheed and adal as usuluddin, risalat and qiyamat. Yes, then of course came the whole debate of who is the successor of the Prophet, how should the succession have been, so on and so forth. So the Shia sect said tawheed, adal, nabuwat, imamat. But imamat, its function was already subsumed in prophethood, because the imamat's function is to explain the real faith. Yes, that was already implied by nabuwa, but then they made it into imama and qiyama, so then it became five, but it's only three, it's minimalistic. Now amar bil ma'ruf, nahyan al munkar, tawalla, tabarra, these are all to be seen as things that are explaining the usul further. Now, tabarra means what, according to the normal person? To swear and to curse and to distance from the enemies of the Ahlul Bayt. I'll be very bold here. Yes? Tabarra is nothing in and of itself. The only thing that is important is love of Allah, His Prophet, and righteousness and His family. Tabarra is an implication of that. It is not religion in itself. Yes? Now, when people do tabarra, I will ask them, come to me and show me which one of our noble imams did tabarra in the way you are doing tabarra. Which one of them? Show me. Which imam ever swore at anybody else? Now, excuse me for saying what I have to. Muawiyah was not a good person. He wasn't a good person, yes? By all rights, this man was not a good man. When Imam Ali's Sahaba used foul language against him, Imam said to them, silence. They said, why? He said, keep your tongues pure. They said, he deserves this. Imam said, your tongues deserve to be kept cleaner. Yes? And in Nahjul Balagha, he says, say to them things that will explain to them the wrongful ways of the wrongfulness of their ways and bring them to the right. Yes? Imam Hussein, now I know somebody's going to quiz me for a reference for this, but it's in the book that's written on the fifth Imam. Imam Hussein writes to the people of Basra and he says, look, of course we are saddened that Ali's position was not given to him, but at the same time we commend the Khalifas to Allah for the good that they tried to do. Imam Hussein is saying this. Where has the community gone? If Imam Hussein is saying this, that we commend them to Allah for the little good that they tried to do, I don't understand where the community is going. Yes? Lady Aisha, can you deny she is the mother of the Mu'mineen according to the Quran? If she is the mother of the Mu'mineen, she is mine and your grandmother. She is our grandmother. If our grandmother did something wrong, yes, which she did, and she regretted afterwards. She regretted it a great deal. She was a woman and she was inadequate in certain ways. Sahabas were good people, but they stole and their hands were cut. They consumed alcohol and they were whipped. They were human beings at the end of the day. They were like me and you to a great extent. And some of them were phenomenally good. The others were like me, normal humans. But should I say bad things about my grand predecessors? Somebody that Allah calls my mother or grandmother, should I say bad about her? Does that really make sense to anybody? Seriously? So tabarra in the way that it's being done, according to my understanding, best of my understanding from the Quran and from the Prophet and the family of the Prophet, is not right. It's not right. Yes? They say if you're a believer, the Prophet or Imam Hussein will come and help you in your grave. Is it true? Allah, the Prophet of Allah says, you will be raised with the ones that you love. Even if it is a little stone, you will be raised with it. Yes? If a person is in deep love with his Prophet, yes? Then of course that Prophet, through the consent of Allah, will help. Yes? If you're in deep love with your Prophet, and you're in deep love with your Prophet because of your Allah, then Allah will let the Prophet help, right? Allah says, there is no shafa'a save by my consent. Allah will give that consent to Muhammad Rasulullah and the noble family of Muhammad Rasulullah to help their genuine, sincere lovers. Why not? Yes? Please explain pluralism. I think we'll come to that in the next day or two. Sorry? No, recite the ziyarat. Of course recite the ziyarat. If you say, La'anallah ummatan qatalatka, that is recited by Imam Sadiq. Imam Sadiq is saying that God cursed the people who have killed you. Yes? The people who killed Imam Hussein, Imam Sadiq says, may Allah curse them. It's fine. Allah says about Pharaoh that Allah curses them. Allah says about the people who hide the truth in the Quran, Allah curses them, the angels curse them, and humankind curses them. Sorry? Look, there are two different things. One is what we understand, black and white. Yes? One is what we understand, black and white. And the other thing is the shubahat that we don't understand. Yes? We can't commit ourselves to something we don't understand. When we understand something, we commit it to ourselves fully to it. Yes? That's all I'm saying. And in that way, I will say the best model is the Prophet and his family. If the Prophet and his family have taught something, that's fine. I'm satisfied with it. But don't move out of the remit of what Muhammad and Ali Muhammad has given. Don't go beyond that. Yes, yeah, stick to that. Now, if you want to ask me about lanat, then I'll tell you. This lanat that we do is wrong. This is hatred. Lana means predominantly. Lana means to shun that quality of arrogance, injustice within my own self before I shun it in the other. Because I am the real Iblis. I am the real Yazid and real Shimmer. Secondly, I'm cursing that person. Fundamentally, when I do lana, I'm cursing my own aptitude, my own ability to do wrong. That is the true meaning of lana. Yes? Secondarily, I'm distancing myself from everyone who has that quality. And then I pray that Allah converts them into good, righteous human beings, as was the case with Muhammad Rasulullah, Ali ibn Abi Talib, and the children of Ali. What did they do? The Prophet found people who buried their daughters, who threw stones at him, who spat on his face, who chastised him. He said, "Ma udhiya nabika ma udhitu." No prophet has been harassed more than I have been harassed. What does he do? He converts their la'ana into godliness. Are you understanding this? But for a person who does la'ana, does not sleep at night, shows he himself is a maloon. How can we hate somebody else? Does Allah allow hatred in the heart of where God lives? Is that possible? Please think about these things. Yes? To be honest with you, Ale Muhammad, if people were to understand them, these are no less than Isa. Yes? The givers of love and life. If only we understood them. They were the people who came to make humans out of monsters after the Prophet. They weren't people who came to curse majority of the humanity. What does Quran say? Quran says, do not curse the people who call on to other than Allah, because they will curse Allah in arrogance. And the people of Imam Sadiq curse other human beings and Muslims? Really? Think about it. Go home tonight and think about these things. Before me and you die, and we stand in front of Allah and His Prophet, think about these things. Yes? By Allah, it is easier to be cut into pieces in this world. It's not easy to stand in front of Allah. It's not easy. Ali ibn Abi Talib said, I would rather stand bare feet on thorns all night long and be dragged on my head in chains than to stand in front of Allah and His and my Habib on the day of Qiyamah and be answerable for doing injustice and wrong to any of their creatures. Think about it. Imam Ali once, sorry, I'm going on and on and on. This is my last comments. Imam Ali once came jubilant from a battle. The Prophet looked at him with admiring glances. Then he said, oh Ali, rather than having killed all these people in the way of Allah, it would have been better for you had one of them been guided aright through you. Man ahya nafsa ka man ahya nasa jami'a. This is the Muhammadian Islam. This is the Islam of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Think about this. When did the difference of iftar's time start from? Now these are fiqh questions. We have 15 sahih hadith, if not more, that all talk about the sunset as the right time for iftar and maghrib. Yes? Ayatullah Khoi and many other prominent Shia ulama have said, sunset is the time of iftar. These are the hadiths. The contrary hadiths are all in their own contexts. But because the Shias have made this into a symbol of faith, then they can carry on doing it. But these sort of giant ulama of the Shias have all said, when the sun sets, if anybody wants reference, I can give it to them afterwards. May we recite a Surah Fatiha for all our marhumin al-Fatiha.